The Philippine Defense Department not seeing major security threats that may disrupt next week's elections. Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana also refutes claims chaos may ensue after the polls. He says government troops are ready to respond should disputes sparked by political rivalries erupt across the country.
Isolated lang.
Mm-hmm.
Yung alam naman ng Comelec kung saan yung hotspot eh, kasi kino, ano na under under Comelec control saka control ng PNP ano.
Mm-hmm.
So far generally it will be a very peaceful election. Meron lang sigurong alam mo naman sa Pilipinas hindi hindi mawawala yung mga awayan ng mga kandidato. So meron yan but it is very isolated.
Mm-hmm.
At saka konti lang yan. Now after election I don't think magkakaroon tayo ng kaguluhan dahil sabi ko nga kung sino yung ipoproclaim ng Comelec, mm-hmm. Yun ang pa natin, ang i-recognize natin na nanalo. Ang inyong kasundaluhan ay gagawin lahat ng kanilang magagawa para tahimik at maayos yung ating eleksyon ngayong narating na eleksyon sa araw, sa Lunes.
Mm-hmm. The Manila Police District now on full alert status ahead of the May 9 elections. Some 5,000 police officers are tasked to man the Philippine Capitol to ensure the safety of voters. The MPD has also prepared the equipment that they will be using next week. Aside from ensuring security, the MPD will also monitor the process of vote counting.
It's all systems go for Monday's presidential elections. Poll Commissioner George Garcia says almost 100% of vote counting machines, SD cards, and ballots that will be used are ready. Garcia also allayed concerns over incidents of malfunctioning VCMs.
Meron po kasi tayong mga hubs, na repair hubs na in-establish mismo sa buong Pilipinas. Walong repair hubs po yon na walang ibang gagawin kung hindi po magawa ng gawin yung mga makina na maaaring subject of repair po. Plano pa nga po ay i-improve ito at increase pa mula sa 8, hopefully maging 12 pa nationwide. At ang plano po, nag-coordinate na po tayo sa Armed Forces of the Philippines na kung saan, kung sakasakali magkaka-problema yung ilang makina ng madamihan, kinakailang i-airlift na po gagamitin natin ng mga air assets ng AFP. Meron po naman tayong mga contingency machine na available po. In fact, meron po tayong 1,000 contingency machine na available.
Over in Marikina, two repaired vote counting machines are set to undergo final testing and sealing Friday. Vivian Guria now joins us on the line to tell us more. Viv, go ahead.
Denise, the two vote counting machines which malfunctioned during the final testing and sealing here in Marikina City last Tuesday have been repaired. Comelec Marikina First District Acting Election Officer Bryant Bucau says one of these VCMs in Barranca Elementary School refused to accept and read additional test ballots after the first one was fed. Technicians later found out it was due to a plastic that got into the ballot exit slot. Meantime, the other VCM here in Malanday Elementary School suddenly shut down without completing the printing of election returns during Tuesday's FTS. But the glitch has also been fixed. The two repaired VCMs will again undergo final testing and sealing tomorrow morning. The local Comelec invited representatives of political parties and candidates, as well as other stakeholders, to observe the FTS, which seeks to assure voters of the vote counting machine's integrity and readiness for the May polls. The other 363 VCMs assigned to Marikina City had earlier passed the final test. They were sealed and stored in guarded rooms within their respective polling centers. The city also received earlier this week the complete ballot boxes and official ballots for the national and local elections on Monday. Denise, back to you.
Thanks for that report, Viv.
A polling center in San Juan also wrapping up preparations for next week's polls. Let's get an update from ABS-CBN correspondent Rafael Busano. Rafael?
Chiron, the Pinaglabanan Elementary School here in the city of San Juan is already wrapping up its preparation several days ahead of the 2022 national polls. School principal and assigned DESO Dennis Baclis says that they didn't encounter any problems or issues whatsoever with the recently concluded final testing and sealing of the vote counting machines. As a matter of fact, these machines are now situated or placed in a room behind me, which is heavily guarded by members of the Philippine National Police and the Philippine Navy. The doors have also been sealed to make sure that no one is able to enter. This year's elections is one for the books since it will be done in the middle of a pandemic and authorities are working hard to reduce, if not completely avoid, the possibility of transmission. Signs have been put up here in Pinaglabanan Elementary School to guide voters where to go. The movement of voters is also controlled with rooms having different doors for entry and exit. While health authorities have constantly advised those who may be ill not to head to polling places, Baclis says anyone exhibiting flu-like symptoms such as high body temperature will be escorted to the isolation polling place where they can cast their ballot. Baclis is appealing to everyone, especially to voters, to exercise caution. San Juan has a total of 12 polling centers, which has around 109,000 registered voters. Ron.
Rafael Bosano with that story. Thanks.
Philippine authorities urge to prepare for worst-case scenarios should there be unplanned maintenance shutdowns on Election Day. The National Grid Corporation of the Philippines says such incidents may cause brownouts. The NGCP assures voters it's also doing the necessary preparations to help prevent disruptions during next week's elections.
Maghanda tayo at aware tayo na may posibilidad na ganito. On our part, no, sinisigurado namin na may maintenance moratorium kami, gaya rin ng mga power plant. Meron rin kaming OCMC o yung Overall Command Center na magiging bukas 24 hours a day, beginning May 8 hanggang May 10. At meron rin kaming mga precaution, mga line personnel na kung sakaling magkaroon ng aberya sa transmission system, sila ay, yung aming mga linemen ay agarang makakatugon dun sa mga pangangailangan.
Some 300 foreign nationals will be allowed to observe the Philippines' conduct of the May 9 elections. That's according to Poll Commissioner George Garcia. But he assures voters there will be no interventions and disruptions as the foreigners monitor the election process. He says they are strictly required to comply with the rules.
Yesterday po, we met with them. There was a formal launching of the foreign observers for the 2022 election. We met with them and we highlighted clearly the parameters of being a foreign observer. Definitely, they cannot enter into our polling precincts. There are ground rules and ano po sila properly advised and at the same time nagkaroon po sila ng briefing tungkol po sa mga ground rules po natin. And we will easily remove any one of them from our country if they will violate the ground rules that we have. Definitely, Sir Herman, I can guarantee you, foreign intervention will not happen in the 2022 national and local election.
The move of Catholic clergy members to endorse Vice President Lenny Robredo is seen to make a huge impact. Political analyst Ramon Casible believes the Catholic Church has a big influence on voters. He also points out the church had a huge role in the downfall of the Marcos regime. More than 1,000 bishops, priests, and deacons have thrown their collective support to Robredo, whom they described as a servant leader.
Lumitaw in public ang mga taong simbahan ano, na Roman Catholic in favor of a candidate. Yung ganong klaseng posisyon kasi may political impact yun. Dahil napakalaking bahagi ng ating mamamayan ay Roman Catholic. Yun ang tandaan natin. Ano, hindi issue ang basis yan.
Meanwhile, El Shaddai's spiritual advisor, Bishop Teodoro Bacani, clarifies their religious group is not endorsing any candidate. El Shaddai leader Brother Mike Velarde earlier gave his backing to Bongbong Marcos, but Bacani insists that's a personal endorsement. He adds many El Shaddai members are not following Velarde when it comes to choosing a candidate.
Hindi naman niya utos yun. Hindi naman siya nag-uutos. Siya'y nagpapahayag ng kanyang preference, ng kanyang gusto. Tapos, sabi niya sa mga tao paulit-ulit, the choice is yours.
A political strategist urges polling firms to reconsider their method of interviews. Truthwatch Philippines head Dante Velasco points out the result of pre-election surveys may not fully reflect the sentiment of the public. He believes the youth are underrepresented in surveys.
The youth are out of the house, which means when the interviewers of Pulse Asia went to the house, probably they have not encountered the young, because the young presumably are outside the house. They are off to work and off to other activities or off to the rallies.
Presidential bet Ferdinand Marcos Jr. continues to lead in the last pre-election survey of Pulse Asia, enjoying a wide margin over rival Vice President Lenny Robredo. Marcos's running mate, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte, also topped the vice presidential preference survey.
Vice presidential aspirant Senator Francis Pangilinan issues a challenge to the University of the Philippines Diliman Council. Pangilinan says the council should name the candidate that it said was not worth voting. In a statement, the group called on voters to choose candidates with integrity and a clean track record. It also urged the public to reject those with records of corruption, lying, human rights abuses, tax evasion, and ill-gotten wealth. But presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos was convicted for a 1995 tax evasion case. More than 174 billion pesos worth of ill-gotten wealth had also been recovered from the Marcoses.
More individuals and groups are joining calls to prevent the family of the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos from returning to Malacanang. The latest to speak out against presidential survey frontrunner Ferdinand Marcos Jr., former Senator Nikki Coseteng. She warns Filipinos about the moral and economic downfalls that another Marcos presidency could bring.
I hope I'm wrong, but I went through it. I went through it. My father practically lost his shirt because of this. Loans were not paid. The banks, suffered losses, severe losses, etc. Mm. Now, what happened then, I can see happening today. Look at all the businesses closing. Look at all the malls that have empty spaces, And a lot of people, developers, etc., that built a lot of condos. I hope this does not collapse like a house of cards.
Vice presidential candidate Manny Lopez wants to put his focus on the agriculture sector if elected. Speaking at the Commission on Elections' final voter education series, Lopez says agriculture plays a big role in the country's economic growth. He hopes systemic and science-backed reforms will pull many Filipinos in this sector out of poverty.
Among the sectors na kailangan pong i-prioritize dyan ay ang agrikultura, sapagkat karamihan po ng ating mga mamamayan ay reliant sa agriculture. Kaya yan po ay bigyan natin ng mas magandang mga solusyon, hindi lang budgetary allocation. Among those that needs to be addressed immediately ay ang sourcing nila ng capital. At yung pong mga production inputs, mataas na binhi, mataas na presyo ng fertilizer, kakulangan sa infrastruktura, yan po ang bigyan natin ng prioridad. Using the build funds na naka-prioritize or naka-allocate sa mga flagship projects. In that way, yung pong benepisyo ay direktamenteng mapupunta sa mga kababayan natin na matagal nang naghihirap.
For presidential candidate Ernesto Abella, it's important to develop mega industries in the Philippines to spur jobs creation. A former presidential spokesperson says this way, Filipinos will not have to leave the country to look for opportunities.
Doon yata nagigir yung ating economic policies na magpadala ng tao sa labas. Kasi nga naman, it brings in about $30 billion a year. So, it readily brings in the cash for us to be able to pay off our debts. Medyo asymmetrical yung ano natin, no? yung growth natin. May kumikita sa lugi na marami.
The Health Department suggests more ways on how the COVALEC can ensure the safety of the May 9 elections despite the ongoing pandemic. More in this report.
The Department of Health assured the public that polling precincts are safe and follow health protocols. In fact, aside from protocols released by the Commission on Elections, the DOH has also given additional recommendations to the poll body.
Sana meron tayong allocated time per voter. We are suggesting that a safety officer should be there, no? Kasi ang ating COMELEC, meron po silang marshals. They have to ensure as well, pag may nakapasok na may symptoms, na ando na rin siya, meron silang isolation precinct, pero dapat masigurado, mai-refer agad sa local government right after the voting para ma-manage.
Adequate ventilation in the polling areas is also recommended. In a private school in San Juan that will serve as a polling place, ventilation is not a problem as all precincts are in a covered gym. Despite this, a member of the electoral board says they can't help but feel nervous.
Hindi tayo normal situation na pwedeng magkumpul-kumpulan. Sana before election, alam na nila yung talagang ibubog nila, nakapag-isip na, at kung kakayanin nilang kumuha ng listahan para madali nilang ma-shadean yung dapat nilang i-shade, yun yung gagawin. Hindi yung hahanapin pa nila, i-check doon pa sila magtitingin, di ba? So, tatagal din sila dito.
In the city of Manila, aside from the final testing and sealing of vote counting machines, voting in isolation polling places was also simulated. Those found to exhibit COVID symptoms or register a temperature of at least 37.5 will have to cast their votes in IPPs. But how exactly?
Pagdating po sa isolation polling place, may pinapirman sa kanya na waiver at authorization letter na pinapayagan niya si isolation polling place support staff na kumuha ng balota niya. Si safety protocol officer ang pupunta sa kung saan mang clustered precinct nakarehistro yung nag 37.5, and then siya kukuha ng balota, and then after po nun makuha ni safety protocol officer yung balota, ibinigay po kay IPP support staff at pinaboto po si botante.
After casting their votes, they will be referred to the local government in order to properly manage their condition. Unlike past elections, this year's polls are hounded by many challenges in the middle of a pandemic. But if other countries were able to do it, Filipinos are even more determined to live through it. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The Foreign Correspondents Association of the Philippines, or FOCAP, says social media firms need to improve their algorithm and establish a direct line with journalists. That says some of its members receive hateful comments online. FOCAP board member Regine Cabato says taking down accounts is not enough, as she believes some of these accounts have already spread false information. She also urges local and foreign journalists to step up their game amid the spread of fake news.
Whoever the president will be, the Philippine press, both local and foreign, we have to close ranks and we have to kind of step up our game. Kasi kakulangan din siguro ng press na nagkaroon ng proliferation ng ganitong fake news, ng ganitong historical revisionism, etc. We have to be on the platforms where the audiences are, places like TikTok, like YouTube, etc. Kailangan na tututo din natin yung bagong language ng ganitong mga platforms. But in a way that, of course, is part to the standards, to the ethical standards of journalism.
President Rodrigo Duterte declares Election Day, May 9, a special non-working holiday. Duterte says this is to allow people to properly exercise their right to vote. There are over 67 million registered voters for the 2022 elections. In other news, President Rodrigo Duterte has appointed Police Lieutenant General Vicente Danao Jr. as officer in charge of the Philippine National Police. This was confirmed by Interior Secretary Eduardo Anio. Danao will replace retiring PNP Chief Dinardo Carlos, who is set to step down on May 8. Danao previously served as Chief of the PNP Directorial Staff and Deputy Chief of Operations Officer in Charge.
Former Justice Secretary Vitaliano Aguirre claims the retractions of allegations against Senator Laila de Lima are only meant to discredit the Duterte administration. He asserts the public should suspect the timing of the recantations, claiming it's aimed at boosting the re-election bid of the detained senator. De Lima has been detained for 5 years now over her alleged involvement in the illegal drug trade. But two key witnesses have retracted their testimonies, with former prison's official Rafael Ragos naming Aguirre as among those who pressured him to testify.
It merong malaking conspiracy para yang mga dating mga witnesses against De Lima ay mapabaliktad. Inumpisa yan kay Kerwin and then kay Ragos. Tapos I was informed that tina-target nila si Nakulamco, si Valeroso, si Junel, at may iba pa. Pati yung driver, former driver si De Lima, ay nababagtad din nila. Yung reaction nito, talagang teach to discredit the Duterte administration na nakataas na survey up to the very end and one out of the president is running.
Aguirre also implied Ragos recanted his testimony for money.
Yung retraction na yan, iisa lang ang common denominator niyan. Ang common denominator ng lahat ng nagre-retract, siguro 99.9% ng lahat ng nagre-retract, lang salaysay, yung pang salaysay sa kusgado ay pera. Binibigyan ng pera yung nagre-retract.
Do you have proof, do you have personal knowledge that Ragos received money in order to retract?
Wala nga, wala pa kung sa ngayon. Kasi bigla na lang susulpot yan after 5 years. You expect me to have an evidence na siya binigyan ng pera.
Senator De Lima pushing back on Aguirre's claims. In an interview with ABS-CBN News, De Lima said she is more interested in clearing her name than winning her re-election bid. De Lima also rejects allegations. She coerced witnesses to retract their statements, saying she has no capacity to do so. She's now challenging Justice Secretary Bernardo Guevara to find out the truth. De Lima believes President Duterte is the one behind the drug cases against her. De Lima is a staunch Duterte critic who initiated a probe into the president's bloody drug war prior to her arrest.
Senator Ronald De La Rosa prefers to have the operations of online cockfighting regulated instead of ending them. De La Rosa cites the revenue being generated from the so-called e-sabong. The lawmaker chairs a Senate Committee on Public Order and Dangerous Drugs, which conducted a probe into online cockfighting. He says they will release a report this week.
Ang rekomendasyon natin kay regulate properly dahil nga sabi ng ating Pangulo, kaya hindi niya pinahinto agad noon dahil nasasayangan niya sa revenue
yes.
na nakukuha dyan para pang COVID response natin, ginagamit yung revenue.
Despite his call, De La Rosa says he still supports the order of President Duterte to ban online cockfighting. In changing his mind, Duterte cited its negative social impact.
Today marks 2 years since the Philippines' largest broadcast network, ABS-CBN, went off the air. Several groups gathered to remember the second anniversary of the shutdown. Jasmine Romero now joins us for more details. Jasmine?
Denise, several groups condemn lawmakers responsible for the closure of media giant ABS-CBN on the second year of its franchise denial anniversary. These groups, the National Alliance of Broadcast Union or NABU, Kapamilya Workers Partlist, and the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines or NUJP, said they denounced the 70 congressmen behind the killing of the ABS-CBN franchise, calling for zero votes for the so-called franchise killers. These groups believe the franchise denial not only created a chilling effect on media, but it also impacted on the access of Filipinos to reliable, relevant, and timely information, particularly during natural calamities and disasters. They also say with the death of the ABS-CBN franchise, thousands of employees were left without work in the middle of a pandemic. These groups are set to conduct a candlelighting ceremony at the Boy Scout Circle in Quezon City later tonight at 6 p.m. to mark the second anniversary of the ABS-CBN franchise denial. Denise?
Thanks for that, Jasmine.
Up next, two Omicron subvariants causing an increase in COVID cases in South Africa.
And the Philippine government's outstanding debt climbs to a new high in March. More news when we return.
Five were first identified in South Africa earlier this year. They have since been found in the U.S. and some European nations. The World Health Organization says it's too soon to know whether these new subvariants can cause more severe disease. But it's stressed testing and sequencing remain critical, even as trends show declining COVID cases.
Globally, reported cases and deaths from COVID-19 are continuing to decline, with reported weekly deaths at their lowest since March 2020. But these trends, while welcome, don't tell the full story. In many countries, we're essentially blind to how the virus is mutating. We don't know what's coming next.
Millions of people in Beijing returned to work, though many remotely, following a five-day national holiday. Officials in several districts had urged residents to work from home after the Labor Day period amid China's continuing COVID outbreak. Beijing on Thursday reported 50 local coronavirus cases, while Shanghai logged over 4,600 mostly asymptomatic infections. The outbreak led to an unusually quiet Labor Day holiday, with more than 40 cities implementing lockdowns or mobility curbs. Dozens of subway stations across Beijing remained closed.
The U.S. Federal Reserve hikes its benchmark interest rate by half a percentage point in its most aggressive step yet to fight inflation. The increase was the biggest in 22 years, following a quarter point hike in March. But Fed Chairman Jerome Powell says this is just the first in a series of 50 basis point rate hikes. The Fed will also begin shrinking its $9 trillion asset portfolio next month.
We are on a path to move our policy rate expeditiously to more normal levels, assuming that economic and financial conditions evolve in line with expectations. There is a broad sense on the committee that additional 50 basis point increases should be on the table at the next couple of meetings. We'll make our decisions meeting by meeting as we learn from incoming data and the evolving outlook for the economy. It's a strong economy, and nothing about it suggests that it's close to or vulnerable to a recession. Now, of course, given events around the world and fading fiscal policy effects and higher rates, you could see some slower economic activity.
Inflation in the U.S. surged to 8.5% in March, the biggest jump since December of 1981. But the war in Ukraine and ongoing lockdowns in China are worsening global supply chain woes, pushing commodity prices even higher.
Here in the Philippines, inflation accelerates to its highest level since 2018 as the economic recovery gained pace. The consumer price index rose to 4.9% in April, faster than the 4% recorded in March. The latest reading breached government's target range of 2 to 4%, but remained within the Philippine Central Bank's forecast of 4.2% to 5%. National statistician Dennis Mapa says while fuel prices pushed inflation higher in the first quarter, elevated transport costs had spilled over and impacted food last month.
Nakita natin itong Abril ay pumalo naman doon sa food items. In particular, I would like to mention four sub-items into the as part of the food and non-alcoholic beverages. So ito ay vegetables na may inflation na 9.2%. Ang weight niya ay 2.8% sa basket. Meat, 4.2%. Ang weight niya ay 6.4%. Fish, ang inflation ay 5.0%. Ang weight niya sa basket ay 5.6%. At yung flour, bread, ang inflation niya 4.5%. Ang weight niya ay 2.9%. So, ito yung nakikita namin na nagkaroon ng impact dito sa mga food items na medyo matataas din yung weight sa ating food basket.
The BSP expects inflation to remain elevated due to the impact of the Ukraine conflict on global commodities. But it also believes lingering COVID-19 woes and the renewed threat of mobility restrictions may lower demand and tame inflation. The central bank will hold its policy meeting on May 19th to discuss whether or not it should hike interest rates to address high inflation.
The Philippine government's outstanding debt climbed to a new high in March. It amounted to 12.68 trillion pesos, a nearly 5% increase from February. Of that figure, about 70% were domestic loans, while the rest were foreign borrowings. The Philippines has been borrowing heavily over the past 2 years to fund its pandemic response. But economic managers say the government's debt remains manageable.
Speaking of the Philippines' running debt, the country has secured another loan just months before President Rodrigo Duterte steps down from his post. Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez finalized a $56 million loan agreement with the Export-Import Bank of Korea. The loan seeks to finance the engineering services for the Panay-Guimaras-Negros Island Bridges project. The bridge is among the big-ticket items under President Duterte's so-called Build, Build, Build program. The U.S. reportedly moving towards imposing new sanctions on Chinese video surveillance company Hikvision. The Financial Times reports the potential sanctions could be administered by the U.S. Treasury Department. Hikvision has been accused of enabling human rights abuses by supplying the Chinese government with cameras used in the repression of the Uyghurs. The firm already faces export and investment restrictions in the U.S. Hikvision told Reuters the company will continue to comply with the applicable laws and regulations in the countries where it operates. Its shares are down nearly 10% following the report.
More to come. A new report shows more people across the world experienced hunger last year. Stay with us. Strong earnings. More from Michelle Ong.
Most Asian markets climbed on Thursday following the expected 50 basis point rate hike by the Federal Reserve. What investors cheered, though, was the Fed downplaying concerns of a more aggressive 75 basis point hike in the succeeding meetings. Philippine shares also managing to climb despite hotter than expected inflation print for April, coming in at 4.9%. ING Bank's Nicky Mapa says he expects faster inflation to be accompanied by faster growth numbers.
Well, I think we have to take a good look at what first quarter GDP will look like. Mm-hmm. And I think for all intents and purposes, it will be a robust print as well as the second quarter. So I think the narrative that the economy is on solid footing is here. And the narrative also that inflation is here to stay should also be up front and center. So we have faster growth and we have fast inflation. So I think it's about time that BSP considers those rate hikes because I feel they've delayed the rate hikes. They're behind the curve now. They may have to resort to aggressive tightening this year, maybe 100 basis points when all said and done at the end of 2022. You start to see inflation at 5% over an extended period of time. That's when you start to see inflation expectations build. And once you lose inflation expectations, you lose your grip on inflation expectations, it's very difficult to get back on stream.
Meanwhile, AAA Equities' Matthew Cabangon tells investors now is not the time to be overly bearish.
It's hard for me to call a local bottom, especially considering that we have this little thing next week called the national election, which certainly could introduce some choppy waters to our market. But that being said, I do think market participants locally have really exhibited a bit of over bearishness the last few weeks, right? In my view, the time to be bearish was 3 months ago, right? Now is not the time to panic. So I think, contrary to what a lot of market participants believe, I think the time to buy is closer than what people expect. I'm eyeing sometime between June and July this year.
For the day, the PSE index gained nearly 1% to close at 68.68, market breadth positive, with advancers beating decliners 3-1 and foreign funds turning net buyers. In corporate stories, PLDT enjoyed a 56% jump in first quarter earnings to 9.1 billion pesos as service revenues hit an all-time high of 46.4 billion, 79% of which came from data and broadband. PLDT says both its home and enterprise businesses hit record revenues thanks to a sustained network rollout and an economic reopening, while the individual wireless business is seeing encouraging signs of recovery. PLDT's Alpan Lilio says they're on track to meet targets for the rest of the year, with service revenues expected to grow by mid-single digits. PLDT had earlier announced a 77 billion peso sale and lease deal for some of its towers and an upward revision of its capex to 85 billion pesos from the initial 76 to 80 billion. Meanwhile, rival Globe Telecom reports an 86% jump in profit in the January to March period as the easing of pandemic restrictions and economic reopening pushed Globe's consolidated service revenues to new record high of 39.2 billion pesos. That's up 4% year-on-year, even surpassing pre-pandemic levels. Total mobile revenues now contributing 69% to total service revenues, and the subscriber base is 10% bigger at 87.4 million Filipinos. Mobile data revenues grew 8%, while the home broadband business declined 4%. But the company says this is mainly due to the transition and migration to fiber. Corporate data revenues, meanwhile, jumped 18%. Still in earnings, chemicals and ingredients maker D&L Industries posted its strongest earnings in 3 years despite the Omicron surge in January, with first quarter net income hitting 780 million pesos, up 12%. D&L cites strong export performance, with export sales up 45%. The segment now contributing 34% to total sales. Also a bright spot, oleochemicals. Over to banking, China Bank enjoyed a 37% growth in earnings in the first quarter to 4.9 billion pesos on higher earning assets and lower interest expense. Fee-based income, though, contracted 50% due to lower trading gains. The bank saw increased demand in both corporate and consumer borrowers, with gross loans up 10% to 632 billion. Provision for credit losses was cut by 65% to 780 million pesos, reflecting improved macroeconomic outlook. The CBAC Bank also declared a 1 peso per share regular dividend and an additional 50 centavos per share special dividend, totaling 4.04 billion pesos. That's 50% higher versus the previous years. And Asia United Bank, the banking arm of the Rabisco Group, saw net income in the first quarter gain 79% to 1.3 billion pesos, citing easing lockdown, a ramp up in vaccination, and an overall improvement in the business climate. In other news, the Lushotan Group expects 2022 to be a better year than 2021 as the economy opens up and vaccination ramps up. President and CEO Michael Tan says he expects increased demand for the products of Philip Morris, Tanduay Distillers, and Asia Brewery. While Eton Properties is expected to see higher occupancy rate, although it will take time for fit-outs of new office and retail tenants. He adds an improved economy also means lower NPLs and higher margins for PNB. He warns, though, of inflationary pressure coming from higher oil prices and some weakness in consumer demand in areas in Visayas and Mindanao that were hit by Typhoon Odette in late December. For this year, LTG is increasing capex by 30% to 12 billion pesos from 9 billion in 2021. This covers a higher IT budget for the banking unit, construction projects of Eton, and Ayala Land Eton's joint venture, which is expected to pick up. And finally, Megawide and its joint venture partners from Japan, Tokyu Construction and Tobishima Corporation, finally signed contract package 104 with the government for the Metro Manila Subway Project. The 17.8 billion peso project covers the construction of underground stations in Artigas North and South, as well as tunnels connecting the two. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Ukraine ready for a ceasefire in the Azovstal steel plant in Mariupol, where the last of the city's resistance is holed up. President Volodymyr Zelensky notes over 300 people have been rescued in two rounds of evacuations in Mariupol and surrounding areas. But there are civilians, including women and children, left at Azovstal.
To save them, we need to continue the ceasefire. The Ukrainian side is ready to provide it. It takes time just to lift people out of those basements, out of those underground shelters.
Mariupol's mayor earlier reported heavy fighting at the plant. Officials were said to have lost contact with troops inside the building and had no way of knowing whether they are safe or not. The mayor added there are still over 30 children inside. Moscow has said it would cease fire at the plant and open a humanitarian corridor for 3 days starting Thursday.
Russia denies it plans to declare war on May 9th. Kremlin spokesperson Dmitry Peskov says there is no truth to these rumors being spread by the West. The U.S. and its allies have speculated Russian President Vladimir Putin could use the May 9 Victory Day parade to declare war on Ukraine. Russia has only been referring to its invasion of Ukraine as a special military operation. A formal declaration of war enables Putin to mobilize reserve forces and draft badly needed conscripts.
The European Union announces plans to embargo Russian oil, its biggest economic sacrifice yet, to inflict pain on Russia for its invasion of Ukraine. The proposals must be unanimously approved to take effect and are likely to be the subject of fierce debate. EU chief Ursula von der Leyen conceded getting all 27 member countries to agree on oil sanctions will not be easy. But the move is a landmark moment in the bloc's support for Ukraine. The EU gets about 27% of its crude oil imports from Russia and a higher share of its oil products, paying billions of dollars a month.
We will phase out Russian supply of crude oil within 6 months and refined products by the end of the year. Thus, we maximize the pressure on Russia, while at the same time, and this is important, we minimize the collateral damage to us and our partners around the globe, because to help Ukraine, we have to make sure that our economy remains strong.
Philippine Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana says it is very unlikely that the U.S. will position its troops and weapons in Manila amid the ongoing war in Ukraine. That's even after President Rodrigo Duterte offered the country's facilities to the U.S. in case Russia's invasion of Ukraine spills over to Asia. Lorenzana notes such a situation will likely not occur since the Philippines is not near the area of conflict.
Ang sabi ko naman sa kanya, Mr. President, malayo mangyari siguro yan dahil unang-una napakalayo natin eh. Kung kailangan, kung nangangailangan lang ang Amerika ng mga paglalagyan nila ng kanilang mga equipment at mga tao bago sila makipag-ano doon sa Ukraine. And mayroong malapit na bansa dyan, yung Korea, malapit, mas malapit dyan sa atin, Costa Turkey, at saka yung iba pang mga NATO forces.
Back in March, the Philippines' ambassador to the U.S. had said Duterte was ready to offer whatever facilities the U.S. might need without any restrictions. The U.S. is the Philippines' only defense ally. A mutual defense treaty binds the two countries together.
More people across the world experienced acute food insecurity in 2021 due to worsening conflict, climate change, and economic shocks. That's according to a report by the Global Network Against Food Crises, an international alliance composed of organizations like the United Nations and the European Union. The study showed the number of people facing hunger rose to 193 million last year, a 40 million increase from the already record numbers of 2020. The Ukraine-Russia conflict was not specified in the report, but the UN's Food and Agriculture Organization believes the conflict stands to have the most devastating impact on food crises.
Before we go, watch out for our special coverage of the 2022 election starting May 9, 5 a.m. Catch that and all the developments leading up to Election Day on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel, on our website, news.abs-cbn.com, and here on ANC. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsai.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.
Transportation to come out, that's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.